Thank you, Hans, and great for inviting me. It's really hard to be here, and I love this place. I really love it very much. Now, first of all, perhaps a little bit about myself, because what I'm doing might be a little bit complicated. I'm a trained philosopher of mind, trained philosopher of religion, but I'm also, and a little bit of psychology to some extent, but I'm working also in neuroscience. So I have been working for 17 years now on the interface of neuroscience, philosophy of religion, philosophy of mind. And that's why people recently began to call me as the neurophilosopher. So it might be something like that, yes. I have been working a little bit yesterday with my paper here, changed a lot, so I will just keep to reading in order to remain within the scope of the time I have. So, my presentation reflects some parts of my recent book. You will find brochures over there. The Human Being, the World and God, Studies at the Interface of Philosophy of Religion, Philosophy of Mind, and Neuroscience. But you will not find everything I will present today in there. The aim of my presentation now is to forward some ideas on the relationship between free will, moral evil, and responsibility that are hopefully of interest for the complex debate of free will. The question that we will hear and have already heard many times in this conference is there something like free will, or is free will always relative to a specific factor? Commonly, people have the idea that human beings are free to perform or refrain from a certain action at any time. In other words, it is argued that human beings do things or refrain from doing things because they want or do not want to do these things. Consequently, this claim, human beings are always responsible for their actions because they intentionally act or refrain from acting. One observation is that the concept of free will or freedom of will actually consists of two value-laden words, freedom and will. Furthermore, there is no consensus on the relationship between the concept of freedom and the concept of will. Some philosophers maintain that possessing a freedom of will means possessing the capacity to make decisions and to act or refrain from acting accordingly. Other philosophers argue that possessing freedom to make decisions and possessing freedom to act are two different things. Possessing freedom to make decisions is according to related to the human will to do or to refrain from acting, while possession freedom to act does not need to have a relationship with wanting or willing to act or not. In other words, in contrast to acting, making a decision typically involves intentionality, and that's Thomas Pink. The question is, can one act freely without willing it? One could say that there is a difference between a person who wills something, intention does, and a person who does something without actually willing it, the action. But is doing something without willing it an act of freedom? For example, soldiers who find themselves fighting a war without wanting it, but do they actually have another choice? Do they possess freedom of action? The question is, when do people become responsible for their acts, and to what extent are people responsible for their acts? Let us take a look at two different views of how freedom and responsibility are related. Libertarianism on one hand and incompatibilism on the other hand. Libertarianists believe that human beings are in total control of their acts, it is, human beings are completely free agents. On the other hand, advocates of incompatibilism argue that human moral actions depend on, to a large extent, if not altogether, on the environment in which people are born, their genes, their desires and feelings that would come over them beyond their own control. And that's also cited from Thomas Paine. The question is, which view would be most adequate in the age of neuroscience, libertarianism or incompatibilism? I argue none of them, but there is a middle way, which I will present later. According to Kant, man himself must make or has made himself good or evil. Either condition must be an effect of his will, for otherwise he would not be held responsible for it and could therefore be morally neither good nor evil. Hence, to Kant, the moral quality of the will is completely self-acquired. In other words, humans are free to do good or evil. Furthermore, before a human being makes a decision to act rightly or to act wrongly, the human being is innocent. Kant tries, from whatever causes were to be found within him or outside him, his action is yet free and determined by none of these causes. If Kant is right, human beings are responsible for the consequences of their acts, regardless of which conditions that underlie these acts. For Kant, something is good or evil if the will which created it is good or evil. In other words, in a Kantian sense, the problem of goodness is the problem of good will. Hence, the problem of evil becomes the problem of evil will. Freedom and will belong together. Such view is philosophical problematic, because such an understanding does not pay enough attention to the consequences of a person's psychological, sociological, and biological environment. If something that ought to be considered as good or evil is due to the will creating it, how should we understand the good intentions sometimes cause that good intentions sometimes cause calamities, and on the other hand, that bad intentions sometimes turn out to have favorable consequences? For example, giving money to a beggar who, instead of buying food or shelter, the beggar buys liquors and finally dies. An example of a bad will resulting in something good would, for example, be a boss ganging upon an employee, finally sacking this poor guy without any firm reason, but the result is that this employee finds a job that is far more better. However, the view that there is no such thing as free will is also problematic, because if there is no such thing as free will to act and refrain from, would that not imply that human acts are more or less caused by chance? Furthermore, as Thomas Pink again asked, would human acts be acts at all or merely ground motions? Hence, compatibilists need to explain in what way human beings could be held responsible for their acts, presupposing everything is predetermined, every act is relative to factors. One such factor, according to some, is the human brain. Already Thomas Hobbes had the idea that free will was but an illusion. Following Hobbes' view, people's moral actions are determined by their previous cultural, religious, educational, environmental, personal, and neurological properties. He didn't say that in these words, perhaps, but that's my implication. More recently, Daniel Wigner collected a variety of studies in his book, The Illusions of Conscious Will, and argued that free will is an illusion. It is generated, not correlated, generated with the brain. However, why being an illusion, it serves as a guide to understand ourselves and to develop a sense of responsibility for our acts. According to him, experience intentionality is a post-action construction. While his work is definitely worth reading, his conclusions are not based on pure scientific evidence. As others, he draws conclusions from scientific research that are not really there to draw. And Peter already yesterday presented the work of Benjamin Libet, so I don't need to go into that. I just will put a little reminder and some reflections of myself. So by way of EG, he showed that brain activity related to decision-making priors conscious decision-making with more or less 300 microseconds. It was concluded that cerebral initiation of a spontaneous voluntary acts begins unconsciously. However, while this challenges the notion of free will, it does not dismiss it altogether. According to Libet, the final decision to act would still be consciously controlled during the 150 microseconds or so remaining after the specific conscious intention appears. The role of consciousness would not be to initiate a specific voluntary act, but rather to select and control a volitional outcome. Another study, there are of course many, performed by Chen Xiong-Tsun and company and team, showed that unconscious neural activity is not only restricted to motor action decision making, but also to abstract decision making. They found relevant neural activity in the medial, prefrontal, and parietal cortex. topics in relation with the default word network, the default word network. Of course, many of you know, but it's also called the brain's dark energy. 4 seconds before the participants reported having consciously made their choice. Importantly, they do not exclude the notion of free will either. Rather, they write, we show that the brain may already start preparing for voluntary action up to a few seconds before the conscious decision is made. These and other studies do not demonstrate that free will is an illusion. What they demonstrate is that person's neural network, perhaps the default mode network, prepares the person for conscious decision making, taking into account, that is my interpretation, the stored information of that person's biology, biological, psychological, sociological, and environmental environment. In other words, a person's bodily and mental experience over time. And I think that's in line with Aaron Church's research. Just an analogy. Suppose that my husband calls me and says, this evening I want to make the nasi goreng. But he says, like, but absolutely not time to do the shopping. Can you do that for me? Okay, I will do that. So then I know that my husband always has certain ingredients that he will always use in his nasi goreng. But then I know that there are also other ingredients that he sometimes and sometimes not uses in this recipe. So what I do, of course, I prepare for him. I buy exactly everything that I know he will use, and that and that and that he might use but might not. So what is happening? I'm preparing for him. I'm like his unconscious neural network, while he the conscious network, neural network then comes home and makes actually the choice how to make his nasi goreng. Nevertheless, and obviously, there are neurological circumstances in which people cannot be said to have entirely freedom of will. Just to give some examples. Lesions of the amygdala occurring in early childhood cause deficits in theory of mind reasoning. Deficit in theory of mind reasoning has many consequences, not least concerning empathy and relationship to others, social engagements as a whole, and so on. Damage to the amygdala, small or large, do have consequences on how people will decide and act. For example, there are studies showing that when the amygdala is stimulated electrically, animals respond with aggression. When it is removed, animals get very tame and no longer respond to things that would have caused rage before. Amongst other DCT, injection, Shami Tucci as well have done such studies. Studies with psychopaths, this is also DCT, show that the volume of the amygdala is reduced, as is the gray matter volume in the frontal and temporal cortex, especially in the right posterior superior temporal surface, in the insula, and increased volume in the striatum. In plain words, the brain functions correlating with empathy are reduced in psychopaths, while the brain functions, and this is interesting, correlating with rewards is increased. Still, with regard to responsibility for one's actions, studies have shown that when persons could score high on psychopathy do understand moral norms, but it is simply disregard them, hence this freedom of will. Another neural function that is important, and it has been mentioned today, is the ventral prefrontal cortex. It is very, very much related to decision making. And ventral medial prefrontal cortex patients have serious difficulties with moral judgment and decision making. They make more often irrational decisions. Another study on such patients showed that they have also difficulties in making decisions that involve future consequences. The ventral medial prefrontal cortex also has to do with feelings of rightness and feeling wrongness. Damage to this function also disrupts doubt and skepticism, and decrease in the activity with aging, making elderly people more vulnerable to irrational decision making. Hence, while there is still freedom of will to some extent, it is not optimal. Then, of course, there are Then, of course, there are severe damage to the brain caused by, for example, brain infarct that might deprive people of their free will altogether. The interesting question is now, what is the relevance of neurologic studies for understanding free will, moral evil and responsibility? In my view, understanding the neural underpinnings is crucial because, on the one hand, it could be argued that those who possess a neurological normal developed and functional brain have the free will to be morally good or bad. On the other hand, neurological studies suggest that being good or bad, being good or not, cannot entirely depend on an individual's free will. It casts a shadow over the view that human beings are really free. The question is now, to what extent are human beings free and to what extent are they determined? In other words, it becomes essential to investigate the extent to which human beings can act voluntarily and hence to investigate to what extent people can be taken to be responsible for their actions. I think that thus far we can conclude that neither libertarianism nor incompatibilism by themselves provide an answer to the question. This is because neuroscience has not been able to demonstrate that we do not possess free will, which goes against incompatibilism, but it has demonstrated that we may have less of free will than we thought, which goes against libertarianism. So we need a third or a middle path, and thus far my suggestion is to call it dispositionalism. There is perhaps a better concept we can discuss that. Being disposed is, in my view, not the same as being determined. Being disposed means that one may, for example, act in a specific manner due to one's personality, temper, environment, and so on. However, none of these traits are really determined. But it can also imply that one may act in a certain way because of one's neurological makeup, which might and will always need to be determined. How is dispositionalism related to people's moral wicked or evil acts and responsibility? In my view, we need to broaden the concept of moral evil. The late Thomas Anderberg, an Uppsala and Stockholm philosopher, dear friend also, divided moral evil into accidental moral evil, which is non-intended moral evil, and active moral evil, which is intended. This distinction is fruitful because it emphasizes the difference between a person who wills something and acts accordingly, and a person who does something without actually willing it. However, in my view, there is need for further distinction if we also want to relate moral action to responsibility. Hence, I suggest four types of moral evil. These are pure accidental moral evil, belief-based accidental moral evil, active but not entirely responsible moral evil, and active and responsible moral evil. The degrees of responsibility lie on a scale between not being responsible on one side, as in pure accidental moral evil acts, and entirely responsibility on the other side, as in active and responsible moral evil acts. So, by pure accidental moral evil, I mean moral evil, for example, caused by human beings who manipulate nature in a way that this manipulation results in some natural catastrophe, for example, the floods. Perhaps the damage caused should not be considered as a voluntary cause, as long as the actors, of course, are not aware that their lifestyle has such negative effects on nature. The act itself, for instance, building highways, can be seen as voluntary. So here, I think, before they are aware of what they are doing, they cannot be taken responsible for their actions. Belief-based accidental moral evil could be, for example, caused by victims of coercive psychological methods. It is victims of mind control or brainwashing. Their acts are voluntary, but are also determined by a belief that is forced upon them, sometimes even with torture. The degree of responsibility here is actually a big question mark. But I would also like to say that under these circumstances, perhaps they should not be considered to be responsible for their actions. By active but not entirely responsible moral evil, I intend, for example, immoral actions of people who suffer from some neurological or psychological disorders. And here, of course, you can name many. I'm just thinking, I'm almost done. I'm thinking about, for example, Alzheimer people who are in the second stage of Alzheimer. They may really be angry and really act wicked, and they do it voluntarily. But I mean, they are only, in my view, limited responsible due to the condition of their brain. The last thing, the candidate for active and responsible moral evil is physical and psychological torture, intentionally causing physical and psychological and physical pain or damage to others, whether it concerns human beings, animals, or nature, is undoubtedly an act of active and responsible moral evil. So these people are entirely responsible for the acts. And this reminds me of Hannah Arendt's words after she attended Anne of Eichmann's trial in Jerusalem. She said that he was not a psychopath, but a thoughtless and terrified normal. To conclude, we should be careful to relate evil to specific individuals, because people and human beings are vulnerable. Human beings are complex beings and morally vulnerable due to their neurobiology, personality, culture, and evolution. This makes the problem of free will, moral evil, and responsibility a very complex one. There is no consensus on the common sense thinking that human beings are supremely free to act as they will. Rather, it seems to be more possible that human beings in some cases act entirely voluntary, while in other cases act in accordance with their culture, psychological, and so on, neurological makeup. And sometimes these cases of action are combined. And I just want to thank you for your attention.